changes to our agenda. First, I will be moving the consent agenda ahead of the special presentation. And under the consent agenda, I will be adding a item under the special presentation, now number five, I'm adding a 5A, which would be the presentation of the Sutphen Run resolution, as well as the others. The Lake Woods presentation will be 5B. Presentation of Germanna Wilderness Area Plan will be cultural assets will be 5C. And there's an addition to the county administrator's report that will be in addition to the Wilderness Area Plan and county legislative priorities. There will be a status of broadband as well as the 2016 capital facilities status, or the bonds. Yes. Any other changes to the agenda?
I think you've been busy enough.
That's right.
All right. Can I get a motion to move to the second? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Okay. First is
item we had our real estate tax bills sent to the printer. They sent us proofs twice, and we approved the date, and then when they actually sent the bills, they put a different date from the one that we approved. And so rather than cause confusion with the citizens by sending up a corrected bill, this ordinance just simply moves the due date by a day to correspond to the bills that were sent.
But that doesn't change the due date for the personal property.
It has no effect on personal property. Those bills had the correct date on them.
Any other questions for Ms. Lashley? Okay, let's open the public hearing. Has anybody signed up for the public hearing?
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman.
Call the first person.
No one signed up. No, sir.
All right, we'll close the public hearing. All right. Can I get a motion?
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion. Roll call, please.
Mr. Johnson?
Aye.
Mr. Goodwin?
Aye.
Mr. White?
Aye.
Mr. Crozier?
Aye.
And Mr. Frank?
Aye. Motion passes 5-0. The second public hearing is the amendment to the taxation ordinance. Mr. Ledger.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, this is an item that was raised recently. We have a provision in our code that provides tax relief to certain elderly and disabled taxpayers. And we had a situation where somebody died in the middle of the year, and the person that inherited it would also have qualified for tax relief, but we didn't have a provision in our code that allowed them to apply mid-year. So this is a modification of our code so that if somebody inherits property mid-year and they qualify for this tax relief because elderly or disabled, then they would be able to make an application mid-year.
Okay. Any questions for Mr. Lashley? Okay, now let's open the public hearing. Do we have anybody signed up to speak?
No, sir, Mr. Chairman.
Public hearing's closed. Okay, can I get a motion?
So moved.
Second.
And I have a second. Roll call, please.
Mr. Goodwin?
Aye.
Mr. Crozier?
Aye.
Mr. Frame?
Aye.
Mr. Johnson?
Aye.
And Mr. White?
Aye.
Motion carries 5-0. Next item is the consent agenda. Can I get a motion on the consent agenda?
So moved.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. White?
Aye.
Mr. Crozier?
Aye.
Mr. Frame?
Aye.
Mr. Goodwin?
Aye.
And Mr. Johnson?
Aye.
Motion carries 5-0. First item is the presentation of the Sutphen resolution. Would the Sutphen family come up here and join me?
Okay.
it's a sad time for the Sutton family, but Daniel made a lot of contributions to the Lake of the Woods. A resolution of recognition for Daniel R. Sutton. Whereas Daniel R. Sutton was born on January 4th, 1941 in Outlook, Washington, and passed away on October 26, 2016, at the age of 75, after a courageous battle with lung cancer. And whereas Mr. Sutton was a proud graduate of the Sunnyside High School in Sunnyside, Washington, and after high school, he continued his education at Eastern Washington State University. And whereas Mr. Sutton honorably served his country in the 3rd U.S. Infantry, the Army's oldest infantry unit, also known as the Old Guard, at Fort Myer in Arlington, Virginia. And whereas throughout his professional career, Mr. Sutton was a hardworking independent contractor building single-family homes throughout the areas of Virginia for over 30 years. And whereas a longtime resident of Lake of the Woods, Mr. Sutton was well known for always lending a helping hand to his neighbors and generously volunteering his time with the Lake of the Woods Ski Club for over 20 years, patiently leading even the youngest members out of ski. And whereas in all his endeavors, Mr. Sutton demonstrated a devoted interest in the welfare of his community and the people he served, and has left a lasting impression on Orange County through his service, example, and dedication. Now, therefore, be it resolved on this ninth day of November 2016 that the Orange County Board of Supervisors hereby expresses deep appreciation to and recognition of Mr. Daniel R. Sutton for his example as an honored and respected community leader and role model. Signed, each frame chairman, on this fourth day of November.
To Lake of the Woods and sharing with us in one of your meetings. It gives us a great opportunity for our community to visually see all the hard work that you're doing and to take part. We appreciate that very much. Lake of the Woods is an effective partner with the county in many ways. We've talked about our tax base that we pay and our food and beverage is over $160,000. We do well, you do well. Our security forces, we had a great example of the cooperation this week with our security and the Orange County Sheriff's Office with an incident at a home here, and Major LaCasse and Sheriff Amos both were in contact with me as we put out information, so we really appreciate all that. Our clubs and civic organizations are very active here, and I think it's really appropriate with the presentation that you have tonight on the Germana history that we did just a historical deal for the Apperson family just this week, so we are very much into that type of history for Lake of the Woods and for the county as well. And I'll make this short because I know obviously I don't miss too many dinners, and I want to make sure we get to that on time. We do have all but one of our board members here with us tonight, and you will meet them as we do our dinner meeting, but I'm very proud to serve with these people. And they are making a great imprint on our lake. I want to thank this group for your work on getting the highway designation for LOWA roads, and that gave us the ability to do some other law enforcement speed things with ours. We appreciated participation in our emergency operations plan, and each year we do that exercise through your county emergency services and your 911 people and the sheriff's office, and that is a great exercise for us to really do things to find out if we're prepared. And finally, and so I can get done and you can keep moving on, and we'll cover some items, maybe two things. We'll cover some other items for discussion in our lunch, but we appreciate what you've done working with us on the with VDOT on the proffer we have, as we're working on a turn signal for the entrance into the lake. My closing remarks would be, we're always asking you, we appreciate what you do. Contact us if we can help you in any way. We want to make this a partnership, and we would enjoy helping wherever we can. Thank you.
Our next presentation is on the Germanna Wilderness Area Plan Historic and Cultural Asset Inventory. Sam Nelson.
Chairman, as Sam makes her way up here, I'd just like to recap what you're about to be presented. As you know, as part of the Germanna Wilderness Area Plan, this board's 50-year vision for this part of the county, encompassed several big categories, and these categories have been under development in various forms. In fact, we will have two actions tonight, this and one subsequent in your agenda in terms of utilities, around certain categories: land use and development, economic development, and historical and cultural assets. And one thing that came out clear in the community's input and the board's process with the Germanna Wilderness Area Plan was that this area is very, very rich in history. History that spans this country's early days before Germanna up into the present, certainly with the gold mining activity that happened here in the late 19th century and early 20th century. And so one of the things that was, needed to be done was to take a document that had been presented as part of the Gateway study, and I'll just reference that, that showed a lot of different assets here, and try to make some sense out of it. What, on a hierarchy, in a kind of a screening process, what made sense, what needed to be known, what needed to be protected, what needed to be interpreted, and such. And so the board commissioned Zan, who is very much part of the Germanna Wilderness Area planning process, very interested in giving her skills in history and such to try to make sense of all the assets that are up here. And so what you're going to see tonight is the fruits of that work. And I think you'll be pleased with the results. So, Zan, did I build you up enough?
Thank you very much. Good evening to all of you. Well, my name is Zan Nelson, and Mr. Chairman, board members, I thank you for actually allowing me to make this presentation here at the clubhouse. And what I'm going to do is go through some of the preliminary slides kind of quickly, but you'll have time to ask me questions later if you like. Can everybody hear me okay? Brian has told you a lot about what you're going to see. I can tell you now, and I will tell you at the end, it has been a privilege to work with Orange County on this project, and it has been an extraordinary education related to the history in this area. So Allison has kindly helped me with this PowerPoint presentation. So if I can push the right buttons, we'll go through it now. Okay, so the background, as Brian was stating, is that the steering committee was formed in 2013, and over a year-long planning process, the working draft of the Germanna Wilderness Plan was finalized in 2014, and public comment was opened, and it was quite a bit of opportunity for public comment. It's one of the things that I thought was exceptional about this process. The following public comment and public hearings by both the Planning Commission and the Board of Supervisors. The plan was formally adopted as part of the Orange County Comprehensive Plan in 2015. Among other recommendations related to planning and zoning, transportation, economic development, and utilities, the GWAP recommended the development and implementation of a historic cultural and cultural assets inventory for the properties contained in the boundaries of the Germanna Wilderness Plan. And the boundaries were focused on Route 3, but not limited to that. It also comes up Route 20 and comes around on Flat Run Road. The county hired myself, thank you, to develop an inventory matrix of the various historic and cultural assets located in the Germanna Wilderness Plan. And here it was broken down into phases. Phase one was to prepare the matrix. Phase two was to populate the matrix with general information and site-specific research. And phase three was to analyze and present the findings. So tonight, the three areas that I really want to focus on is, the first one is to show you that. That is what Brian was talking about. It was a map produced in the Gateway Study, of which I was very much a part of, and each one of these circles indicates an historic site based on what is recorded at the Virginia Department of Historic Resources. And it's quite overwhelming to just look at that. So the plan was to find out, maybe you could use the term demystify, but to find out what each one of those circles actually represents. And the Virginia Department of Historic Resources has a database that, although it's kind of clunky and cumbersome even by their own description, is absolutely a wealth of information about every one of those circles and what they mean, what their significance is. And so we developed a matrix that simplified and illuminated what those circles mean, and was divided up by each one of the sub areas in the GWAP. So this is our matrix. Now let me see if I can remember how Allison told me how to open that up. Okay, Allison, I can't remember. Nope. Don't want to do that either. So, okay. All right, Allison, I'm sorry. When I work on somebody else's computer and somebody else's technology, it's a little different. Okay. There were approximately, there were some duplications of sites, some classified under one category and also classified under another. So we have an estimated number of 128 to 135 sites that we had to look at, analyze, and assess. And so what we have now is this, really it's a very useful matrix that identifies each site by its Virginia Department of Historic Resources number, specified to one of the sub areas. So there are some links here. I can show you quickly how this matrix works. If I can make this little cursor work here. Okay. Let's do just the first one. It's an archaeology site. And this will open a map with all the numbers that are assigned by the Department of Historic Resources in that sub area. Helps you locate where those sites are. But here's, to me, the
the most exciting thing, let's see, how can I scroll over? I want to scroll over to the report. Oh, thank you. I forgot I'm in this other thing. All right, so on that particular site, if you were looking at this and you said, okay, I want to know more about that site, then you go to this link and you find the full report. This tells you everything that the Virginia Department of Historic Resources has on that site. It is an incredible amount of information. Okay, so now, we can come back to these if you all have a question about it. Don't say, Allison told me that. Okay, so, no, I don't want to go there. Okay, so then we get to the conclusions, which is the report on the findings. So I want to reiterate, all sites of potential historic value that are currently located and reported and at the Department of Historic Resources and located within the GWAP area have been reviewed and listed on the matrix. The description, historic significance or lack thereof, and all VDHR data is available on the matrix, which I've just kind of showed you very briefly. In this area, in keeping with the vast amount of undeveloped Virginia land, the area is littered with historic resources, not unlike everywhere else in Virginia, at least trace evidence of Virginia's vast history. The sites designated as either eligible or potentially eligible for federal listing on the National Register are fortunately already protected, either by the National Park Service, the Germanic Colonies Foundation, an agency of the Commonwealth of Virginia, or are in private ownership. Some of that includes some very unique spots here inside the gates at Lake of the Woods. These sites preserve and in many cases interpret the vast history of colonial settlement and the American Civil War. The remaining sites have either been determined ineligible for federal listing or do not contain enough substance to add value to existing protected locations. Now there's one more little button in there that I didn't get to Allison in time, but I think it's important as we review the final slide. Having said this, there are, however, a few additional sites that reflect opportunities for interpretation of other periods of Virginia history, not the American Civil War, not colonial settlement. So my recommendations are these: partnering, where feasible, with the identified groups that I mentioned on that other slide to support their efforts to preserve and interpret the history of colonial settlement and the American Civil War. They're great partners. They're already doing wonderful work, just like the Lake of the Woods Civil War Study Group is doing here inside the gates. Secondly, the county and citizens may wish to focus attention and available resources on the existing sites whose related histories have yet to be preserved or interpreted. And that would add an even broader appeal as a tourism destination along this GWAP corridor. It's just chocked full of history, of a huge variety in a short amount of space. So these areas would include Native Americans as a tourism destination along this GWAP corridor. It's just chocked full of history, of a huge variety in a short amount of space. So these areas would include Native Americans, African Americans, and the gold mining industry. Examples of what that might look like would be interpretive signage along a walking trail or a recreational park near the Rapidan River that identifies American Indian activity. An outdoor exhibit located on an accessible and appropriate site that interprets the vast story of gold mining, including the village of Vaucluse, and or interpretive signage at historic Pilgrim Church, right across from the gate there. There's your turn. I would be happy, I'm so pleased that there's such a nice turnout here. I'm pleased to have offered this to the Board of Supervisors, this report, and I'm happy to entertain questions. I can't promise I'll have the answer, but I will try. Yes, sir.
Yes, in the beginning of the matrix, you had prehistoric sites listed up there. How were those determined? Yeah.
Those were determined often by and prehistoric does not necessarily mean dinosaur period. It means back into the American Indian or Native American period. And so they may have done a shovel test and come up with fragments of artifacts that relate to that time period. Yes?
Will your report go up on the Orange County website at some point so that we could look at it?
I would have to refer that question to the Board of Supervisors.
Yes.
I think that is the plan.
Quick answer to that is that this is to be a working tool for the community, but also for the development community. What we wanted to do is to have the results of this study be available to developers or anybody wishing to develop property so that they can be informed about the historical context of their property. And you know, working with the county, if there's a land development decision, then there's a collaboration can be around in preserving, interpreting, or something like that. But the intent was to take that map with all the circles and get it down to what may be relevant in the ongoing land use and development process that this area will realize over the next 50 years. And so that's really the tool of it, but it is a community document.
We're celebrating our 50th anniversary of Lake of the Woods this year, and it's just, that's an interesting part of our history too, so.
We just wanted to make sure that we knew where these things were.
Yes.
So we didn't inadvertently pave over something of historic significance without knowing about it. That doesn't necessarily mean that we wouldn't develop an area like that, but we need to know, and that's what this whole process has been, to identify the significance of these various sites.
I knew that was your purpose, but other people may come up with other purposes.
Sure, and the information will be there. All of this stuff is public.
And if I might add, one of the things that I offered in doing this research to the county, and I imagine they will include that in what is going online, is a list of vocabulary words that the Department of Historic Resources uses in describing many of these sites. And sometimes they're just not intuitive. So there is a glossary that will help anybody that's looking at that. There also is some definitions and explanations of what's involved in nominating a site for the National Register or a historic site for the Virginia Landmark Program. And there is an extensive material on Virginia's laws regarding cemeteries, because there are cemeteries scattered about the area on private property. One of the things that I will mention to you, I mentioned the number of sites, and it's something that I had to kind of get my head around. Many of the sites are identified as either archaeological or architectural. And so I wanted to know what the distinction was. And so here's my layman's very simple explanation of the difference between those two sites. Architectural is anything they find that is above ground level. Archaeological is anything they find that is below ground level. It's an easy way to explain the difference.
Thank you, Sam.
Thank you very much.
All right, next item on the agenda is new business, the second floor courthouse project. Mr. Hildebrand.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. Presented to you a memo briefly explaining the project. You guys are well aware of what we're trying to do on that second floor. I think some plans were distributed, if I'm not mistaken, to everyone. So the essence of my memo is to seek board approval to solicit bids for this project and then to accept the low bid, providing that it's within the amount of money that we had budgeted for this project. Also asked Aaron Kane to attend. I'll tell you that Aaron has done the vast majority of the work on this project, and he can certainly answer any questions that you may have regarding the project and the plan.
The HVAC rework, will that accommodate any modifications that they want to do in the near-term future, or do we have to rework things again?
Really we don't have many issues long-term in that building with the HVAC. We do have a few that will be addressed in this project on that specific floor. So, yes, to answer your question.
Okay. I don't want to do the job twice.
Yeah, we're doing our best to avoid any future headaches with the HVAC system.
Okay. Any further questions?
The users of the space, have they seen these?
We have a nod at least.
Okay. So, Mr. White, the users are Judge Somerville that is initiating, along with Judge Somerville, Juvenile Domestic Relations Court, wanted to open up a mothball courtroom on the second floor. In doing so, needed to bring the JDNR clerk's office up. The space had been allocated really oversized for the clerk's needs now, first of all. Was identified 10 years. The Commonwealth Attorney's Office is Chief Mike Al. They need additional office space. And so what we're going to do is allow the Commonwealth Attorney to expand their space into the existing space, relocate the 16th Circuit Court Services Unit into some space in the center, and then also the JDNR Clerk's Office. And then doing all that will allow the second floor courtroom to become operational, as Judge Somerville has requested.
That's the reason for my question, is that this is not when it will become a county-occupied space, it's going to be the courts. And so we just want to make sure that we have their, that they understand what we're doing and agree with it, so we don't end up with a bunch of change orders and these kind of things.
Yes, sir. They've all been shown this and given an opportunity to make comments.
I've kept the lines of communication open with the judge, for sure.
They provided most of the basis for the design of this in the first place, didn't they?